Like you, I've seen the news about the recession, the debt crisis, the bailing out of banks, and I'm convinced we'll all come to grief. The politicians and media talk about saving the banks at the expense of everything else. Forget pensions, health, or public services. They think the answer is to save the banks, restore the money system, and return to economic growth. But we disagree. We believe now that we've got a money system that is so dysfunctional, we don't want to restore it. And economic growth isn't the answer either. We've been trying to make sense of all of this. Maybe you've been trying to figure it out too. We need to be ready. We need to ask the question, what would be better? Because our governments don't have the answers.
This is a unique moment in history, both a crisis and an opportunity. Most of us know that we're reaching the Earth's limits. Climate change, mass extinction of plants and animals are the start of it. The effects are beginning to hit us now with the extreme weather we've been seeing, leading to crop failures, rising food prices, and we also have rising fuel prices, and lots more. You've probably seen it on the news. But at the same time, and also for the first time in history, we are linked, we are connected in ways we've never been before, by our cell phones, our mobiles, by our social networks, by the internet itself. And that is giving us possibilities for governing ourselves, possibilities for supporting ourselves that we've never had before. And it's why the ideas in this film are not a utopian dream. They're necessary for our survival. The best part is that we can start now, and lots of people are doing just that. We don't have to wait until an enlightened government takes power. We need a revolution in our hearts, not on the streets.
Dr. Alexander is one of many people we have found who are thinking this through, and he's right. You know, we are all connected via social media sites such as Facebook and Twitter, and this might help us build a supportive community instead of a system that is leeching off us all.
We have an upside-down economy. We do things for the wrong reasons. That means we do everything for money instead of to serve the community, to provide well-being, or to look after the natural world. So the money system is not the real economy. That's the message, really. The real economy is making stuff, doing stuff for people, food, etc. But the money system dominates it and distorts it.
Despite what politicians say, it isn't really jobs or money that people need. It's fuel, it's homes, it's transportation, food, and means and ways of serving our communities in return. What's really exciting is that we are learning of many ways of doing exactly that without relying on a job that you hate. And in those places where money troubles have really hit hard, people are beginning to figure this out.
Let's go back to basics. We're going to take a trip to the past before money was invented. Money was invented in the earliest civilizations, but before that, for most of human history, there was no money, not even barter, just mutual support. For hundreds of thousands of years before civilizations, we lived as hunters and gatherers in small nomadic groups. People shared their food, built shelters together, looked after the young and elderly, because that worked better than going it alone. That is what it meant to be human. We are the ultimate cooperative ape. Our bodies, hands, our brains, our minds, even languages and cultures are adaptations to being cooperative. Living in supportive communities is the human birthright, not being a good market trader. That early economy wasn't barter or primitive versions of money, where I won't do something for you unless you do something for me. No, it's a community looking after itself. To be part of a community is to be in an ongoing relationship where people give and get from each other and for the group, trusting that they will receive and that it will benefit them all. And it is that quality, not the hunter-gatherer lifestyle, that we have to reclaim if we're to build a new way of living that works for us and for the planet.
In the future, we'll see the reemergence of community services through the use of online networks. We'll be finding new ways of getting what we want and serving our community with little or no money. Here's a taste of what such a network might look like.
I helped to set up a community exchange using social media. People are invited to join, and inside the community, we all keep an eye on our reputations. This inspires trust and is pretty successful in keeping out those people who would prey on other people. Members can ask for help and offer skills. We found that people ask for and offer just about anything. They mostly do things as favors for each other, but sometimes it's for money. So the little money we do have stays within the community. We also have our own local money. Look, here it is. Or we can pay by text message. Our local money is backed by the reputation of each member, and we're never short of it. We've kept plenty of good local businesses from going under this way. A big plus is that our community is more social than media. We have lots of parties and family events to keep the community strong.
I use Oscar's group as a clothes designer. I recycle old clothes and tailor them so they're unique and exciting. I have regular customers who are loyal to me because we enjoy a personal relationship. I know what they want and they know I'll do my best to deliver. It's an ethos based on trust and honesty, so if anything's wrong, they'll tell me and trust that I'll put it right. I might not get rich, but I am comfortable enough. There are other designers with similar businesses to mine, but we're not in competition because we each have our own loyal customers. That means we can work together, learning, sharing, and ultimately contributing to the fabric of our world. It feels so much safer and more comfortable than the old days. I work for my friends as a favour, and they do things for me. Some pay me in our local money, but I do need ordinary money to pay some of my suppliers. I make everything to do with money public, so everyone knows I'm not ripping them off or exploiting anyone. And everyone knows how much I believe in looking after the environment. After all, my business is about recycling. And by working with other clothing workers, we've learned how to be very efficient in our energy use and how to reuse everything. We make sure all of us keep our quality standards up. It's so much better than being in competition with each other.
That vision of the future is so different to what we have now. Instead of buying from strangers who don't have your interests at heart, you buy from people you know and trust. But what about now? What can we do to trigger a process we have just seen?
We found lots of community projects that seem to fit the bill. Community farms, energy companies, transport systems, you name it. These ordinary people just like you and me who have set up community enterprises, providing life's basics.
As you can imagine, they're often short of money, because like most of us, they're caught up in the money trap. But they have created their own currency. If you haven't seen any, here's some examples from England. It's great! And with these, you could also pay by text or email. People are discovering that they can develop their own currency and support everyone in their area.
So what can we do in these difficult times? There hasn't been a collapse of the money system yet, but here are some things we can think about. First, look around your community and see what's happening. You may be surprised how much there is. Google for Transition Network Transition Movement. That's probably the best starting point I can suggest. Join in or start a new community enterprise for life's basics. It may be food or transport or energy, childcare, whatever suits you or suits your local community. And don't expect too much at this stage. The job is to learn how to do it. Secondly, and this is really crucial, learn how to work collaboratively, effectively with your friends and neighbors. Learn skills of good listening, skills of empathy, and especially learn how to handle conflicts constructively. Thirdly, if it's possible, learn how to set up the infrastructure for your community enterprises. That might be a community exchange or a local currency or community loan funds or whatever works. Again, don't expect too much. The idea is to learn at this stage. Finally, what you certainly can do is spread the ideas. Learn. Read and talk about what's happening. Have informal discussions with friends and neighbors and find out what makes sense to you all.
And if there is a real crash, suddenly all those community enterprises, such as food, energy, transport, that seemed a little marginal before the crash, will suddenly become lifelines for those people with no money or facing disrupted services.
I hope we've given you some food for thought. Fundamentally, this is about a change in the way we see ourselves. Politicians talk about doing better than our competitors, other people from other countries who they say are others, not us, the ones that we care about. But regardless of where you're from, what affects the individual reverberates on us all. We're all connected, we're all interdependent. There are no others, there's only us. And this idea is growing, that we're not, first of all, Americans or British or Russians, Chinese, Brazilians or whatever, but first of all, people of the Earth.